Hacky, just to give you a quick rundown if you missed it, Corey was doing a show at an improv in Texas, I believe. Mm-hmm. Earthquake came to see the show. Corey said he was going to try to get Earthquake some tickets out there to watch the show, but Earthquake ended up in the green room that was designated for Corey, mm-hmm. and he was in there chilling with his people, supposedly getting high and eating wings. Long story short. Then he ended up supposedly kicking out, or at least the people that was in there that belonged to Corey little crew was no longer in the room, and Earthquake locked them the fuck out of it.
Yeah.
So now, let me tell y'all how I hear this shit.
It sounds like Earthquake got the juice to me.
Nigga! Okay, so listen.
I'm just saying.
You want to go first, Packy?
Listen here, my nigga. If this is your venue,
you said that.
Listen, if this your venue, this is your green room, all your people backstage waiting on you to finish doing your thing, and you supposed to come back there and y'all supposed to party it up, how the fuck is this nigga coming in taking over? I mean, granted, he's a great comedian and all of that. You feel what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And he's supposed to be a nigga. But at the same time, first off, a real homie ain't gonna do no shit like that. And second off, how the fuck do he got more juice than you at your own goddamn show?
Hold on, listen. Packy, I love you, dog. listen. Let me tell you how I heard it.
I need to make some t-shirts like this.
Or at least a meme and shit.
Yes, right.
So listen, this is exactly what I heard. First of all, y'all forget Earthquake been in the game as long as Corey and also been a club owner his whole motherfucking career. You think he don't know the owners of the improv? Fuck Corey. At the end of the day, Corey, my friend that owns this fucking establishment, I can walk in and out of this bitch how I please. It may be your green room tonight, nigga, but my homie own this bitch.
Yep, and we finna come in this motherfucker and roll up a half a pound of weed.
And I'm gonna get my dick sucked by this crack hole while she.
And I got ring on. Bring it some wings, nigga.
So, but I don't think he came even with that bad energy. I think he came with the energy of Packy. Like, I know my nigga. Like, for example, let's say we got a guy we know he be doing too much.
Yeah,
but that's my nigga though. He do too much, but that's my nigga. Now all of a sudden he at our show. And I find out he doing too much like we know that he like to do. I'm going to be mad and I'm going to check him and I'm going to holler at him about that. But I'm not going to be so mad that I get on air like, let me tell you how long I've been hating this nigga. Let me tell you how long I never wanted to be this nigga friend and I don't want to smile with this nigga. Like, bro, he must have thought it was cool. Because y'all get down like that, or you be faking like that. You didn't even address the nigga from what I heard. It sounded like you sent some other niggas to address him.
Yeah.
Some off-brand niggas to him. Because he thinking like, I don't know you. Corey, I know. The owner of this motherfucker, I know. I don't know you. Who the fuck is you telling me to get the fuck up out of here? Bitch ass nigga. You know what I'm saying? Man, shut the goddamn door. I'm about to get my dick sucked.
And eat these goddamn wings.
And eat these motherfucking wings. I'll holler at Corey later because he going to check you for trying to check me.
He said, now let me get back to my eight piece and my eight ball, bitch.
Exactly. So this is the energy I'm sure that Corey fake ass be giving niggas this feeling of we fuck with you like that. You my nigga like that. You making niggas feel comfortable to do these kind of things.
You know, now that I think about this, the story he told right before that Earthquake story, he told a green room story. Like, you know, Corey tells a lot of stories about people that want to get in his green room, which to me sounds like him being arrogant at the time. Like, yeah, I'm doing a show. I'm Corey Holcomb, and you just want to be in my green room because I am who I am and blah, blah, blah. This is the first time his green room space that he feels like the king. He has the crown. He can do what he want to do. Because somebody else, he said earlier or the day before he had a show, said somebody was outside and asked a person to come in and say, hey, tell Corey I'm here to come outside. He said he wanted me to come out there after I got off stage. Like, I ain't trying to do that. And said, dude knocked on the door. And then after he didn't get a answer, dude opened the door to the green room and walked in. Corey didn't say who it was. He didn't say who it was, and he gave dude a little bit of props saying, I like the guy, that's why I don't want to blah, blah, blah. And I guess it had to be somebody that knew Corey well enough to just walk in his green room. Because anybody who's smart enough to hear what he's been saying about certain comedians wouldn't just do certain shit to be the topic of discussion that Tuesday. So it's like it's that God complex that made him feel like, damn, somebody's stripping me of my power right now.
You know what I'm starting to notice? We all fuck with Corey comedy. Like even with the things that I say that don't sound like in his favor, I respect the nigga career, his comedy career, but he has not got the accolades that some of these other men have got. Mm-hmm. So he probably tired of going. He knows that when Eddie Griffin got a fucking green room, ain't nobody allowed in that bitch. Mm-hmm. He know when D.L. Hughley or some, you know, one of these other motherfuckers or Earthquake, when they got a green room, ain't nobody allowed in this bitch.
Yeah.
But when Corey get booked at a motherfucking club, opener, all y'all names on the goddamn green room. The opener get to use the room.
Security.
Like, nigga, you coming in a bundle, nigga.
You coming in that motherfucker.
It's a Corey and friends on the green room door. You know what I'm saying? Nigga, shut the fuck up. So
a nigga
probably,
that just stumbled in the Corey and friends. And shit like
so he don't like the fact that the other people getting different levels of respect. When they got the green room, he trying to demand and get some footing for his. But no bullshit, when DL was here, he had a big ass nigga in a suit, clean as a bitch, standing at the side of the stage like this in military style. Like, even though he was clean and player, you know that nigga wasn't about no games.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if this the nigga standing the whole goddamn hour and 20 minutes while you do your show, standing right there by the stage, waiting on a motherfucker to do something. That mean that same nigga back there regulating your goddamn green room or making sure everything going your way, all that. That's what bosses do. Not send they homie back there to whisper to a nigga what you feel in your heart that you said you didn't want to say or you was afraid to say or whatever the fucking reason was. Right. Then the nigga Eddie Griffin, I use him as an example because when I saw him, same thing. He got a nigga that standing there with bottles pouring this nigga glass after glass of champagne while he do his comedy and that nigga like this. Laser focus, waiting on a nigga to try him.
Mm-hmm.
So, Corey, you talk that boss talk. Where's your fucking bodyguard? Where's that manager that's going to regulate all this shit for you? And quit smiling with niggas because your first, I've seen what he said. He said, now I ain't got to smile with you now. Well, if you ain't respect the man, why the fuck was you smiling with him to begin with? I don't smile with niggas I don't like. I don't try to befriend niggas that I don't respect.
Hell no. Nigga better hope I don't whoop his ass right there.
Just stay away from me.
Shit. You know how I get down, G.
And I expect you to.
If
so
I don't
when
fuck
I hear
with
niggas
nigga,
like him
I
acting
don't
like
fuck with a nigga and a nigga know I don't fuck with. You feel me?
Yeah, yeah.
And he know it's potential that I'm gonna end up taking off on your bitch ass while we right here.
Thank you. I want you to know how I feel about you. I want you to know how I feel about you.
Everybody that has found out that Corey don't fuck with them has been through the 5150 show. That is a fact.
But he was just, it was all good just a week ago.
Mm-hmm. I mean, and it'll be back good the next week because that usually happens too. He'll go off 1 week, then the next week be like, I had a phone call with the brother and everything went smooth. You know, I ain't going to say nothing about him. He ain't going to say nothing about me. And it always is because they all have to work together.
I got one more thing I want to point out about how this nigga be moving. When he's spilling the beans, it's always shit that already was out there. Mm-hmm. But he act like he got some inside fucking information. I don't know if y'all noticed, but I've been hearing that shit about Quake for a long time that he get down.
What's up, buddy?
Matter of fact, he has said he fuck with the Booger Sugar. What? You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
He has said it.
Yep.
So now all of a sudden you acting like
you ain't done yet. Oh,
you ain't muted,
Jim. Okay, when I get done.
So look, this is what the nigga would do. Let's say we already knew the tabloids already said something about a specific celebrity. Yeah. So when Corey go on his rant, I know shit about you. I know about that boy, about the this. Nigga, everybody do it. It's on Baller Alert, motherfucker. Like, you ain't telling nobody shit. You just... hate, nigga, like it sound like hate every time. Mm-hmm. What y'all think, man? We can move on from this too. I don't want to stay on it too long.
I mean, I think that burning bridges is a professional job for Corey at this point. And I mean, he talks about it. He said he don't care. He'll burn the bridge. What bridge we burning tonight? Type shit. So it's like it's inevitable, and I think that the comedy community knows that about him as well. So I don't think a lot of people take things to heart. But when things start catching traction, because he says a lot about a lot of people, but only certain things catch traction when he talks about certain stories or things that he's allegedly went through or some shit with somebody. So this story alone, it's gonna catch traction. And I guess since Comedy Hype picked it up, he might end up doing an interview with them, or maybe respond to the shit, because I mean, they talking about people that were there and who could validate what happened. I mean, they talk about Marcus, but of course, you know, Marcus is gonna, you know, validate Corey's story, but they talking about other people that was there that was like, yeah, that shit happened. And regardless if it did happen, if it didn't happen, the point of somebody saying, I'm glad this, you know, him saying, I'm glad this happened, I'm glad we aired this out so we don't have to smile around each other, it's like a person telling on themselves. You were the one going around smiling in somebody's face. You were smiling around somebody and acting like you were cool with somebody, and you really had a vendetta or a grudge against them for whatever reason it was. And you just waited for the moment to air that shit out.
Bro.
Yeah, that shit weak, though.
Like I said, people think he be on some real nigga shit. That's what this is my issue, man. When I used to listen to 5150, when he was talking about females and women and shit, he'd be kind of right on point with relationships and women. Yeah. Every time he talk about some real nigga shit, I'm like, that ain't no real nigga shit. That's some hoe ass shit you talking about. But for young people and people that don't, they look at him like big homie or an uncle or a daddy or whatever the fuck they looking at this nigga like. I'm like, he leading you niggas down the wrong path for hoe-assism. You know what I'm saying? He don't know what the fuck he talking about some real shit. He do snake shit, sucker shit, lame shit all the time. And this last little shit, man, it's just like one more example of who in the fuck is taking this shit serious at this point. The reason I don't be going in or even giving a fuck to do shows about it is because what is we going to keep talking about the same shit for? I been made my mind up.
Yep.
Yeah.
I know who the nigga is. I don't care about this dude like that. But I will say this. He clearly said, I couldn't wait to say this. I'm glad I get to do this. Because nigga, that means you never fucked with this nigga, man.
Exactly.
Stop smiling with niggas you don't fuck with.
You've been faking the whole time with this nigga.
And I guarantee you feel that way about Kevin. I guarantee you feel that way about Nick Cannon.
Mm-hmm.
They said but he
as there's a hope that this nigga can help you, you gonna hold your fucking tongue.
Mm-hmm.
You're not coming out the bag on RZA. RZA six something and fucking put them hands on your leg. You ain't coming out the bag on Craig. You will come out the bag on Marcus, and I'm pretty sure it's gonna happen.
Oh, it's gonna happen eventually.
He low-key sneaking the shit out now.
Yeah.
And if Marcus don't care or don't, maybe that nigga playing chess. Maybe Marcus playing chess.
But
like, I know you a hoe-ass nigga. I'm just going to do what I got to do.
So naive that you don't know this little slick hating shit. You know what I'm saying? You know when a motherfucker say some little slick hating ass shit, bro.